So thanks so much for having me here. I love seeing people like here and engaged and eating lunch, because I teach and I always tell my students, bring your breakfast. Like, I want you to, they're engineers and their lives are really, really constrained, and so I want them to make sure that they're eating. I mother them a little bit, I have to admit. Ahead of this, some of you who are students in the class got a packet of poems from me, and those are some things. I'll read some of those things, as well as a few things from the book. I brought in revisions of one poem, just so you can see how poems get revised, often many, 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 many times, and those are the poems that make it. I could have printed out hundreds of pages of stuff that is never going to go anywhere, because that's how it works sometimes. But I wanted to give you one and show you how something can start with a very small idea and eventually become a poem. But first, I'm going to start with reading from my book. I write a lot about family and how hard it is to have kids, and being in the military. I was in the military for 7 years, which was a great experience for me. But for those of you who are vets and, you know, citizens of the world, understand that there's a lot of moral ambiguity in the military, and so I write about that as well. But this is called Where Babies Come From. And this one, my daughter takes a lot of credit for. She's 7 now. But when she was smaller, she had a little stuffed star. And one day she said, could you hold this? And she was going to use the bathroom. Hold this, Mom. And so I took it and I went, oh, it's so weird to be handed a star by your daughter. And somehow that stuck with me, and this is what it turned into. I thought they were handing me a baby, but it's a star in my arms, a very small one, just born. Whoever said they twinkle has never held one. It's blue and not very warm, and though I don't know a thing about stars, I start to worry. I give a tickle, blow on it, sing a little song, all my tricks. The star perks up, then settles into me like it belongs. Everyone else at the party is clustered by the hors d'oeuvres. Hey, I say, hey, I should probably give this nice star back. Blank looks. I mean, it's not my star. It doesn't even look like me. But it sort of does, right around the edges. So I try again. Okay, it does sort of look like me, in the way that everything in the universe resembles everything else, in that interconnected way. You know, a breeze starts in the Horsehead Nebula, and we feel it in Bear's Paw Galaxy. Or a butterfly is trampled by a horse, and I can't remember what's supposed to happen with the horse and the butterfly, but I know it was profound. They've turned back to the food, what's left of the warm brie. These are not the people you want between you and the lifeboats. A woman approaches. Cute baby, she says. She keeps her hands behind her back. It's instinct, you know. If something's held out, you can't help but take it in your arms. And the next one is called homunculus. And this is a word and an idea that I've sort of been hung up on for a long, long time, most of my life maybe. And homunculus was, you know, before there was a real understanding of how babies were actually made, that and before microscopes had advanced to the point where we could look at some of these things on the more microscopic level, there was the idea that the man's sperm held a very tiny human in it. And that human was often portrayed as being very adult-like, even though they must have known what fetuses look like, right? Women would have had, you know, stillbirths and miscarriages, you know. So they would have known those things, and yet somehow that was the idea of this fully grown human, just very, very small, that had to take seed in a woman. So it's called homunculus, and here's my idea of it. Who doesn't love the idea of a little body wrapped up in another body? If someone hadn't already thought of it, I'd invent the homunculus. I'd put little people everywhere, not just in sperm, but wood glue, the popcorn pieces in the couch, the gills of fish, orzo, pearlescent teeth, navy beans, and of course, teardrops. every teardrop would have a little person, and when the tear splashed down, the person would be free. What I can't decide is if the person would be a baby or an adult. Baby problem, no homunculus-sized diapers. Adult problem, your conscience made real. Or what if you fell in love with that little mite? Physically, how would you, split the household chores? Maybe I'm lingering on details when the big picture is still pretty cool, because these homunculi would honor me as their creator. I'd thought to put them in the dewdrops, the coagulated beef grease. They'd hold little parades, march with their tiny signs bearing aquarelles of me, shout their thanks, which would sound like a lazed buzzing of bees. Because there's so many of them, they'd do all the things I couldn't. They'd be kinder and better. They'd have time to pet all the good dogs, plant more flowers. There's a swinging contra dance band called Einstein's Little Homunculus, and when Brendan asked me what that meant, I told him. How do you know that word, he asked. I said, I thought everybody knew it. And this one my son gets to claim because it was his art project, and so he brought home a little earth mock-up in paper mache, and we had to hang it from our light, where it sat and got dusty for a long time until I dared take it down. And it was made, they used a balloon and covered it with paper mache and painted it. So this is called Art Project Earth. Balloon, then paper mache. Gray paint, blue and turquoise, green, a clouded world with fishing line attached to an old light, original to the house, faux brass chipping, discolored, an ugly thing. What must the people of this planet think? The ground knobby and dry, the ocean's blue powder, the farmland stiff and carefully maintained. Sometimes they spin one direction, then back again. How the coyotes howl. How the people learn to love, regardless, the majesty of their own towering hearts. The mountains, which they agree are beautiful, and the turquoise. Never has there been such a color, breaking into precious and semi-precious stones. They build houses from them, grand places of worship, and there is much to worship. Look up, for instance, six suns, the wonder of it. First one, then the next, eclipsing the possibility that their world hangs by a thread. Really, I realized looking through here that I actually do owe my children, I mean, no surprise, but a lot of lines and ideas going on. So I don't know, perhaps when they move out of the house in, 8, 10 years or so, I'll just stop writing entirely, or I'll have to find a new career because they're my source of inspiration a lot of the times. This is called Lost Mountain. I hate when I misplace entire geographical features. There was the oxbow, that's understandable. Its meandering ways, how easy to set it on the countertop or above the fridge and walk away, then think of it weeks later, all dried out. Blame my husband, if I can, since he is forever depositing items on the mantle. Next, the savanna, or just really a portion of the savanna. I don't want my muddle-headedness out of proportion. Yes, it was large enough for two lion prides and their prey, but it wasn't the whole thing. Slip behind the couch, as savannas sometimes do, and it wasn't until the vultures started circling that I knew. And what a shock then to find the savanna, which honestly no one had missed, instead of the ice cap, which we talked about every day. The salt flat was not my fault. And the hills, who can see them through the haze? Then the volcano, which you wouldn't think I could lose, what with the accompanying poisonous gas, molten lava, etc. But I have a knack for this. I am forever losing sunglasses, too. How my husband hates that, since I like the expensive polarized type. The delta, the river system, the continental divide, the little desert, and then the bigger one. the worried looks on the children's faces as if I had misplaced the whole world and lost something that was really theirs. And see, I owe this next one to my kids too. This is very problematic because we think we give our children so much. Here they are giving so much to me. But maybe that's a truth that parents come to anyway, whether you write poems about them or not. This is called Rumors of Her Death Have Been Greatly Exaggerated. I'm gonna drink. You get to think about that title. Let it sink in. Mistake one, driving by two cemeteries when the kids are tired. Mistake two, saying only some people get buried. Where are the others, my son asks. So I have to explain cremation. I'm smart enough to leave out burials at sea, bodies never found, the yawn of earthquakes, missing children, teens on spring breaks that never end, bodies hidden, basements and old barns and attics, what war can do, shells, mortar rounds, the terror of Claymore mines. They're filled with old screws and nuts, metal scraps twisting through bodies until they embed deeply into trees, even rocks. Someone angry invented these, someone who lived in a junkyard. So I don't say this. All the while, I'm trying to change the subject, get them home. Look at the Christmas lights, the yellow car, the cement mixer. But where do you want your ashes, he says. Where is it that you love? He's crying. He's tapping my shoulder. I'm exclaiming over a stray dog, and do you think we'll get more snow? Wouldn't you love more snow, Walker? He's saying, when is Daddy going to die? Don't die before me. I have both hands on the wheel. I'm remarking over the stars. Help me look for the moon. I'm slowing for a stoplight that is red, 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 red. She's my plant.
Ringer.
She is. She really is. She's my ringer. That's Hetty. Thanks for coming, Hetty. And Mary Claire, you're such a surprise. I love it. I know people here. This next one's called chiromancy. And chiromancy is not a word I knew until I had the idea for this poem and I started to write it. And it means palmistry, palm reading. One of the fun things to talk about is, well, how do these poems get created, right? Not everyone has these experiences, okay? I had this thing happen. It's in the poem. I cut myself. I mean, you know, I'm slicing avocados and I cut myself. This is not a huge basis for a poem, right? But some other things had happened that made me think that there might be something there. And so then I started researching parts of your palm because I wanted to know, would I have done damage to myself the way could I have? What was going on? And then ran across palmistry and chiromancy, and that immediately fascinated me. Like, here I had cut a part of myself that people think is a divination of the future. And so I love that idea and use it. And it's not the central theme to the poem, but it does help push it forward. And so for folks who feel stuck in their writing, I always say, one of the ways to unstick yourself or to make it bigger than just about you is to go and do some of that research. I research continuously. If I don't have the internet, I don't know. I'm sure people wrote before it. I'm old enough that I did, but I feel so very, very dependent on that ease of getting more information. And this poem is one of the ones that really reflects that and helped me shape it a lot. There's a new line on my left palm, from thumb almost to wrist, knife slip. Part of it bled, but the rest is dry riverbed, as if I'd run out of blood, as if the drought and famines had come, as if the ocean receded and kept receding, rows of beach houses left inland and dry. I was cutting an avocado at a campsite in California, which wouldn't be exciting, except the avocados there are 25 cents, which is enormously exciting to those on my coast. So this line has joined the other lines on my palm, my heart line longer than life, the warble of fate, future in a skin fold, past tucked in the simian crease, the stubborn head, the planets in my hand. Below this, veins that appear more blue each year, the skin thinning, the lungs filling a little less, and now there's another line to consider. Perhaps it is my Swiss Army line, or who taught you to hold a knife line, or you think that's bad, you've got an artery about an inch away line, and the new line pointing to the artery, the wrist's soft pulse so loved by the suicidal in their warm baths. They must be more committed than I, with more on their minds than inexpensive avocados and a little boy looking on. Mommy, did you cut yourself? And I dropped the knife and the fruit, luckily not on my foot, because I wasn't certain which had wounded me. So fast and sure, it might have been the avocado lashing out. And I stared at them both, pinching shut this new open part of me, this new access point with blood scarleting in the air. What joy to be blood escaped and sun-filled at last, satiated, set free. And to distract my son, I thrust both hands under the picnic table and said, did you know that knife is one of those funny words that starts with a silent K, like night? And he said, you mean night like a warrior night, or like the night when it's dark? For a long moment, I held one bloodied hand in one uncut hand, and for the life of me, couldn't remember. How about I move on to some a couple of military poems? Yeah? All right. Again, and I like to say this because I know I often have vets in my audience, and I see a look of dread on their faces sometimes when I start in, because they think I might have had a terrible experience in the military, and am writing about that. And the thing is, I loved it, and I love that time, and it continues to inform my life in really surprising ways and in really unsurprising ones. Like, I can't be late anywhere. I try. I really do. I tried a little bit today. I stopped and picked up dry cleaning, and then I thought, that's good, that'll put me back a little bit. And then I got here so early that I drove to the Green River recreational area, and I sat and I ate my lunch until it was time to come here. And I was still early. And it's not like I don't know where this is. I used to live in Greenfield. That's just how I am. So this is called Back Blast Area Clear. So I served in the military from ages 17 to 24, right around there, 25, 7 years. And I was a photojournalist, but everybody goes through some of the same basic training at the beginning. And from there, we differentiate into our specialties, usually. That's how it works. And backblast area clear is simply something that you say when you have a weapon that has both a forward target area, but also has backblast to it, in which you can hurt someone who's standing behind you. I shot one of those, I say to Dennis, pointing at the screen. It's a light anti-tank weapon, a LAW, long fiberglass tube next to weightless. I was 17 when I picked it up, drill sergeant beside me on the firing line, an instructor guiding this gigantic straw onto my shoulder. Even the small size uniform looked ridiculous on me. So I have the LAW on my shoulder and it feels good. Not like the M60, which was like dancing with a barrel of oil. The LAW was nice. A little plastic scope pops up with red lines in a circle. Downrange, there's a huge hunk of metal that looks like a tank. I take off the front cover, a black plastic cap. Take off the back cover, another plastic cap. Both swing free. This thing is like a pixie stick. It's so light. If I'm ever in a war, I am definitely carrying one of these, I think. It's pale green, somewhere between moss and sand. The instructor loads the thing, and now it's a loaded law, still not heavy, but lethal. Pretend it's someone you hate, drill sergeant says. I'm 17. Firing line clear, back blast area clear, cheek, chin against the tube, line up the scopes. The trigger is under a squishy rubber cap, not a rifle trigger at all. There's no one in the tank. Though I'm sure there was noise, I don't remember it. Just the joy of being on target, some metal crumbling downrange. Then it was another girl's turn. Did you hit any helicopters? Dennis asks. Don't be silly, I say. They don't let you shoot helicopters. But of course, they do. While I was in the military, the book given to soldiers for their initial entry training was called A Smart Book, The Soldier's Manual of Army Training. You are nodding like perhaps you know. And it's called something different now, and they have like a bunch of different ones, like Warrior's Manual. They're all warriors now. We were not warriors when we went through. Like, I don't know. I miss being a warrior. I guess I was just a soldier. I like that, I think. So they had these smart books, and I have a stack of these now, including ones from when I served in the military, and then ones that came later. I have one that's about as up-to-date as I could get in the 2000s. I also have the version that was used in 1941, and comparing these things and reading what was considered important to know is really, really interesting, and also seeing how the language has changed. The one that was written in the 40s, and this was when as wide an economic range of mostly men going through it would have been all men in the regular army at that point, were going through. There was a huge economic and educational range of people that were going through, but the language is far elevated to what you read now. So I find that enormously interesting. But they're all broken. These are all tasks that are broken down. You know, take your rifle apart, clean your rifle, how this works, put it back together, how that works, step by step by step. And so I've written quite a bit from these, and they all start with Army Smart Book, even if it doesn't come from the era where they were called smart books. But then sometimes I invent ones either based on things that have happened to me or things that other people have told me. And so this one's called Army Smart Book on Being Lost. Step number one, berate yourself for not taking a buddy to go pee. Step number two, don't panic. You may choose to A, yell and wake up one of the other girls, or B, stay quiet, embarrassed to speak. With option B, move deeper into the woods. Number three, it's your first time away from home. Number four, when your toes hit the ocean, you'll know you're screwed. Number five, you're in camouflage but want to be found. Isn't that funny? Come on, it's funny. Step number six, leaves at night feel like little hands. Number seven, that's a lot of little hands. Number eight, the enclave of tents should be at irregular spacings through the trees. Don't make it easy on the enemy. Number nine, or each other. Number 10, technically, you're all still children, but soldiers. Number 11, you can't drink or stay out past 2300, but you can shoot people. Number 12, did your parents sign the standard in loco parentis form? Number 13, loco also means crazy. Number 14, thank you, Spanish class. Number 15, where it says you can shoot people, that means people of the army's choosing. Number 16, with no visual cues, subjects will wander in circles as small as 20 meters. Number 17, false dawn caused by sunlight scattering off dust. Number 18, how it will make your heart sing. It will feel like first love, imagining the night gone. Number 19, dust rearranged, light shimmers off. It's you and the dark again. Number 20, you're made to look like trees, to disappear. The news is always a great source of inspiration. The news hands you stuff all the time.
The problem is I don't really get along with the news, so I have to kind of get it while I'm working out at the gym, and like CNN is on and I can read the subtitles as they go by. And this is exactly where this poem came from, called Double Arm Transplant, because this was the fourth time they had ever tried this double arm transplant. So a vet had lost his arms and received a transplant for both arms. It was the first that they actually considered successful. And the amazing thing was, and this is not in the poem, I'm telling you because it fascinates me, and is how the nerves in the arms only grow an inch or two every year. So even though he'd had these arms grafted on and it had been a successful transplant, the nerves, he still couldn't feel it. And over time, hopefully, he'll be able to feel to the end of his fingertips. But for years, he won't be able to. And this is just mind-boggling to me, right? I mean, medical, wow, you know, consider that in the versus the Civil War, for instance. The Civil War, it was just take out the saw, and now we're putting arms back on people. And then you think, and yet we keep making wars where you have to get better at being doctors. So this is called double arm transplant. And it starts with a quote from the actual vet that this story was about, Brendan Morocco. And those of you who have the packet can look at that, but I won't read it right now. Even grafted limbs sigh when the rains come. The hands, those twin divining rods, may tremble in the presence of an old love. Now they're the arms of a veteran, the hair that grows from the arms, a different shade. Since the transplant, he writes left-handed. He waits for the hands to reveal their previous life as farmer or electrician. By a piano, he pauses to see if the wrists rise to the music, if the knuckles love the baseball, if the fist curls in anger. Before, did he drum his fingers on the desk? Was the salute quite so crisp? On its own, the pinky angles to the teacup. It's the giver of these arms speaking whenever he debones a fish or juggles. Every time a tennis ball comes down, it sits in the palm for a moment, then rises again. This is one, the double arm transplant is one I wish I'd given you, now that I think about it, that I'd given you more drafts for, because it was radically different from how I started out, in part because it didn't feel like poetry to me. Like, I felt like I had some ideas that were, and I kept pushing it through, and I could even see where it was going to end up. But I couldn't get that first half, especially. Like, I had him holding a lover and, some other things, and I couldn't make all of that work. And so I went, you know, if I'm going to write poetry, it needs to look like kind of like poetry. And so I went back there and really worked on those lines a lot. Right, because it's a job, and you work at it. Sometimes you get it right. Sometimes you pour yourself another glass of wine. Oh, my kids come back. Look at that. This is also in the packet. This is a couple down now. This is called Civil War Reenactment, Look Park, Massachusetts. So not far from here. You all probably know where that is in Northampton. The bridge needs defending. Choke point between swing sets and water park. A gray soldier tells me not to go beyond the picnic tables. A stealthy Union man checks his phone. We're front seat, lunch spread out, and while the battle rages, I eat cold corn on the cob, which always takes a while and requires looking down to see what's been consumed. Children, there's watermelon. They eat watermelon. A man beside a tree crumples. Another fixes a bayonet. I tell them what I know of war, the battle charge to come. They want to know why you don't hold bayonets like knives. I say, to keep your distance, still so close the distance between two bodies. I don't say, for leverage, to drive the bayonet deeper, to force the point into the stomach of a man. The firing stops, the yells of men and boys. When two grapple and one falls dead, I look back to my corn, which I've neglected. Later, they'll help each other up, brush each other off, but in the charge, I heard them wanting. There is no blood, of course. Behind us, an unlucky family sings happy birthday to a 2-year-old above the din. At the first battle of Bull Run, spectators dressed up, women with opera glasses, women selling pies, far enough away that when the big artillery began, they applauded, sure the war would be contained in one weekend in this bowl of grass and stone. Later, we ride the kiddie train through the tents of soldiers and civilians in knickers and long skirts. Look, they took their kids, my two exclaim, glad. The tracks hairpin by the amputation demo. I remind them about starvation and disease. My daughter wants to know about dysentery, smallpox, yellow fever. She likes the sound of that. Her favorite color is yellow. The train rumbles through a tunnel. Beyond it, men in gray, bandits, rebels, are set to rob the church, set to rob the train. The children clutch play coins given in advance and hand them gleefully to a smiling man. The children are not scared, and the children are not scared. And when I say, you know this is not what real war is like, they say, I know, and when the train stops, they run off to feed the deer behind the bars. This is called Wait 5 Minutes. And this is a saying with which you'll all be familiar. I duck into the visitor center and shake the water off my jacket. The woman behind the desk asks if the rain stopped. When I say not yet, she says, if you don't like the weather here, just wait 5 minutes. Well, isn't that true? I reply. What I like about the 5-minute statement is that it's always said with the air of a grand but knowable secret being given away. It takes both people speaking their lines, nodding and smiling at just the right times. I like the predictability of it, and when someone says it to me, which is often, I play right along as if it were new and wondrous, a thing to be turned over and over. Sometimes I'm even the one to start it, and the other person will look at me with an air of gratitude and say, well, isn't that true? How much fonder could I get of humanity? In New England, it's as close as we get to hugging. Another batch of visitors comes in, and I can feel my heart swell. Soon enough, we'll greet each other. Outside, the rain goes on and on. Thank you. And so, we have time, and so I thought I would ask you guys if you have questions, you know, about the writing process, about why I can't stop writing about my children. I swore I was going to, and then they keep coming back. I don't know. So the question was, does writing about my children make me think about my own childhood? I don't know. My kids have a very different childhood than I had, which there probably aren't very many people who don't hope for that when they have kids, yet, that they'll do something a little bit differently and, you know, hopefully a little bit better, but may not. I mean, lots of you, I'm sure, have come from absolutely lovely families, and you just want to replicate that experience, and fantastic. Does it make me want to write? So I do write about my childhood. There are some poems in this book that that address that. I usually find those a little bit sadder. Maybe because it's hard to write happy childhood poems about your own childhood. I don't know. I've never tried it. Have you? I know. How about you, Mary Claire? Have you?
Not too many.
Yeah. So I don't know. Maybe when it's in your own childhood, you have to go back to like when you fell and broke your arm and stuff like that. Like somehow that's where you get the. Have you?
Oh yeah.
Happy childhood poems.
Sure.
And like they were, you, and they're in your books or.
They're 10% happy, 90% miserable.
Yes, which I don't think is how our childhood is. I mean, I think my childhood was. Yes. Thank you. I don't know. You write about the things that get placed in front of you, and
So the poem he's referring to is in the book, and in it, and I'm not giving anything away that's not in there. I talk about my dad, who was sexually abusive to other members of my family, and the ode to the fan is a fan that I literally stole from the house when I left and didn't tell him, and you know that part's true, and like hid it under some blankets and like drove it off. And why I stole the fan, I don't know. It was like really? Why didn't I take a wallet? What was I thinking? I stole like a $5 Woolworths fan. There aren't even Woolworths anymore. But that's what I took with me. Fine. And so I write about that because my dad was very fixated on the idea that I had it. And so we didn't talk for a long time, and then we did a little bit, and he would say, you know, where's the fan? You have the fan, right? And like he could not let go of this. And I played along with it a lot and sort of used it as a way to, like, you know, this very weirdly passive-aggressive way to kind of win. But the poem is oddly like triumphant and joyful. Because I did win, you know?
Yeah.
I get to live this a great life and have good friends and family, and he did not. And so there, you know, that's a lot to feel triumphant and good about. So, but I would say I don't write about my childhood a whole lot. I guess I just don't feel like I have a whole lot to write about with it. And others do. I know others who have, you know, led, I don't know, we didn't move, we didn't, you know, like, no big, you know, I just kind of ran around in the woods for 18 years and then I went to college. So, which is, I guess, not a terrible way to be. And, yeah, so, yeah.
In your poem about the creation of the paper mache world.
Right.
For you, what was the significance of the six?
And as it turns out, like after I wrote the poem, I went back and looked at the light and there were actually five. But, you know, here's the thing, and this is when you can have fun, because poets, we're not memoirists, and even if we were, we wouldn't quite be bound to truth. We're not news reporters. So I get to change whatever I want. I get to take a story and enhance it. I get to make things up completely from, you know, just from whole cloth. When my siblings read my book, they went, we have to talk to you about some of the things that are in there. And they were really sort of traumatized by it, and I had to explain that that though there is a framework of truth to my book and to some of the poems, you know, you can't say you have a framework of truth but that it's truthful. And so I used many details and hung many things on it and occasionally invented things entirely. And so the reason that I went with actually six sons instead of five is because six sons sounds so much better than five sons, right? So you hear that alliteration, and you get to do that, right? You get to change whatever you want. You get to, you know, even though he was making the earth, if it had fit in the poem better that it was Venus, I would have done that. Or I would have made up something entirely different. Like, you know, in a way, this was, you know, this, you're required to hang art projects for a certain amount of time, after which you hope there's a little self-destruct button on the bottom of them, and they will just destruct, and suddenly you'll have all this free refrigerator space for other stuff. And so we had it hanging up for a while, and so there's no significance to it except that it sounds nice, right? Six sun sounds really nice, and that whole idea of an earth spinning under these multiple suns was a lot of fun to, you know, consider that, and also about how, you know, when you start something spinning one way, it will eventually start spinning. It will, you know, reach its whatever it's called, the apex of its spin, and then start back the other way, and that's a lot of fun to think about as a writer.
Inspired you to initially write?
Oh, so I've been writing for a long, long time, and in fact, I thought I would be a writer for a long, long time. If anything, I thought more strongly that I would be a writer when I was five than I did when I was 25. So I was sure that I wanted to be a writer, and so my mom was very supportive of this, and she would take paper and fold it in half and run it through the sewing machine. And this is something I do with my kids now. Run through the sewing machine, you have a book. Like, woo, you're instantly published. A copy of one. You can write whatever you want in it. So my mom made all of these books for me. And even before I could write, I would dictate stories to her. They were mostly about dinosaurs. And I wrote little poems. And so I would take long baths. They must have been hours long. I can't believe I'm not still pruned from it. And I would dictate these stories to her, and she would read them back to me and leave space for me to color in pictures, and I would color in pictures. And so I knew what I wanted to do, and then at some point you realize, well, that's not going to earn me a lot of money. And you have to do other things sometimes. And so I had to, you know, cast around, and as it turned out, I really liked teaching. And you know, so I do that part-time. I'm not full-time, and I'm grateful that I get to live a life where I get to, you know, teach part-time, which gets me in front of people, which is really good for me, because then you're not just, like, sitting at your desk all day long and making yourself frustrated. And I get to write, and I get to meet my kids off the bus at 3:30, and that's a really nice way to have your life structured for me. Other people will be different.
You find yourself cycling through different themes of writing, and just like, you book of this type of thing, you book of that type of thing.
I do.
Visit them, finish them later.
I do.
How many different types of things do you juggle at once?
You juggle whatever comes at you in some ways. I mean, if you're writing a, you know, if I'm writing a poem and it's about a topic that I've been to many times, I'm like, well, here's another one on that topic. And if it's going to be a good poem, then I honestly don't care what it's about. Although recently I started writing about my dad again, and I went, oh, really? Like, I don't know if I want to give him any more my energy right now. And that doesn't mean I won't come back to it, but at the moment I felt like I didn't want to do that. But I have a lot of things going on now. I have two, I feel like I have two books that are really growing for me. And one is a set of poems that's in response to military culture. And so that's going, but it's a little more slowly than I would like. And in the meantime, you can't just force yourself. I will only write about the military. I don't know how novelists do it. They have this stick-to-itiveness that I think I don't have, or something. I don't know. Maybe they need to escape from it too. And so I have that. And then I just have other. So it's military and other. And then the other poems come along, and so I work on those. So right now it feels like two different books are forming, and I'll see which one wins. And then I'll have to put all that energy into getting it published and all that, which is very time consuming. It really is. It's shocking, like, how much work, especially these past few months, have been with once I knew the Pen Award was coming out, and my book was going into a second printing, and now it's being prepared for a third, and having to, like, just really, I have to read my book one more time. I will die if I have to read it one more time. You know, but it's funny when I see folks read, other poets read, you know, they'll often just read straight out of their book. And I'm like, really, you don't want to read some of your shiny new poems? Because I always want to read shiny new poems. Like, I get so excited about them. I want to read shiny new poems. And then I think, if it actually occurred to me today on the way here, I went, those shiny new poems are part of another book. And I'm going to have to read those. And I'm going to get so sick of those. And then I'm going to have to read the other shiny new poems in the future, which means I'm always borrowing from the future, which is a bad way to go. But I still read you somewhat shiny or somewhat newer poems. Because I can't help myself. They're more fun.
Do you find that reading the newer stuff, at least I find this, it's a way to test ground for a poet?
I'm often surprised, not often, like, I do this all the time, but I'm sometimes surprised when a poem that, and you've, I'm sure, had this happen as well, Mary Claire maybe too, where a poem that you felt feels great on the page, and you start to read it and you're like, oh, I have just stepped in quicksand. And you're actually scanning ahead to see if there are like 10 lines or so that you can cut from the thing, because you realize the energy in the room just is dead. And, you know, I mean, I've had poems that have been, you know, well received in print and all of that, and yet having to read them, for whatever reason, sometimes it's I don't know if it's the audience, the room, the whatever, you're like, oh my gosh, that is not going to work. And then there's others, the tried and trues, right, that you feel really good about doing again. And that, I mean, you can tell I have a lot of these mostly memorized at this point.
Self-delusion, which is fine, but you read aloud.
Yeah.
It won't let you escape
the truth. Mm-mm, because you know, as we can talk about being a good speaker a lot, but there is a
there is a real thing about being a good audience too, right? And if you've ever taken a speech class, you've probably had somebody tell you this, that that to take this forward when somebody is giving a talk, to make eye contact with them and nod sometimes, you know, things like that, that you have a responsibility as an audience member to do that, that you are giving some energy to the speaker who will in turn give it back to you. And it just grows. It's this great, great thing. I have started on poems, I'm like, oh that was bad. And it's a fine poem. It just shouldn't have been read in that moment, in that space, in that whatever. And so there's poems in my book, for instance, that I've never read and never want to. And I think they're fine poems. It's not that I dislike them. It's that they don't work in a reading. So I don't ever read them. So don't ask me to read one.
Do you belong to a critique group of any kind?
I do.
Show your work, too.
I do. It's interesting. So I am part of a writing group that I have been part of for at least 10 years. And these are all, we're all poets of, you know, roughly the same caliber and interest and all of that stuff. So it's a very even group, even though we're very different writers from each other. And I love that. I find that enormously invaluable. At the very least, having deadlines is really good. Like, oh, we're meeting in 2 days. I don't have anything new. I have to write something. So those deadlines are absolutely wonderful. But also, I have learned over the years not to bring in things that I feel finished. Like many of the poems I read to you today have never been through my writing group, because I'm at the point in my writing life where I feel really good about, I can take a poem from beginning to end, if a lot of times, and know that it's done. And don't try this at home. But I'll write poems too where I just feel stuck. I'm like, oh, I know it's not, like I feel it, right? I work at this, you know, you're good at what you do, I'm good at what I do. And so I feel that I'm really stuck. And those are the ones that I will bring in and go, oh, help. And they're so good. Like, they'll attack it from a completely different angle and have some totally new thing to do to it. And, oh, thank goodness. Like, then you get to shake it up and re-see it, and or just throw it away and never look at the thing again. And that's fine, too. That happens.
I love the dual nature of your life. You teach technical writing to engineers.
Love the engineers.
And then you have this, you know, do you ever try to engage the writing with a more poetic sensibility?
Oh, no. No, but with a poetic sensibility, no. I'm not looking for elevated language from them. I'm not if they write in passive tense, you can write in passive tense all day long when you're an engineer. You just have a good time with it. Oh my gosh, passive tense. And, but no, we don't do poetry in my tech writing classes. We don't. They know that I'm a poet, and they've been privy to all the awards and things of the past half year, and they're just sweet and lovely about it. But they really need things that are useful to them in their line of work, and so those are the things that we work on. I mean, I do certainly work on being concise in your language, and that's something that poets think about a lot, and I have them think about it a lot too. So those things. I mean, personally, I think poetry is good for everybody, both the reading and the writing of it. It's helpful in all types of writing that you do, because there is an attention to word by word, to sounds, to clarity, to not having to give so much background to a piece, whatever it is, about learning to slim that down, that I think is useful for everyone. Also, I think, you know, I'm a poet, right? So, but I think poetry can speak to us very deeply in ways that many other forms of writing can't. And so, everyone should read it. Everyone should write it. Yeah. But my technical writers, they can do that on their own. They have to. Thank you. Thank